church body as we begin our morning glorifying God. Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth.
You've done for me. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, kids. Welcome to family worship. We're so excited that you get to join us here in the big room. Maybe you've always wondered what happens behind those doors when your parents walk in there. Now you know. To help you kind of engage with this, we have a handy dandy special kids bulletin. So I don't know if you got that as you came in. If you didn't and you would like one, just go ahead and raise your hand nice and high, and we will get you a kids bulletin.
Do we have
some? Couple over here, a couple back there. If you're an adult and you want a kid's bulletin, we won't judge you.
It.
All right. So this will help you kind of follow along with what's going to happen and what you're going to hear as we study God's word in just a little bit. There's also a special quiz on the front. Don't worry, there's no grades. It's just for your own personal benefit. So I think we've got a couple in the back. All right, anybody else? Cool. So hang on to that as we get going this morning. That'll kind of help you follow along with what is happening. Now, we have the boring adults bulletin. So if you would like to take a look at that, just a couple of things that we want to draw your attention to. First, you just saw the video promo for FX. That's Family Experience. We think that families coming together and having an awesome experience together is really important. It'll give you something to talk about. If you come out on February 12th, you will see some crazy, hilarious things, some things you never would expect to see in church, maybe. And you'll walk home as a family having something to talk about, both about the funny experience that you had, but also things that are true about God and his character. So it's a great kind of conversation starter for your family. You'll have an activity, all that kind of stuff. So it's really exciting, February 12th at 6 o'clock. You'll see... Can we go back to that last one? I didn't even talk about that one. Basic training is coming up next week. Now, if there's any eighth graders in the room or parents of eighth graders or friends of eighth graders, this is for you.
This is for me.
Your
have one of those.
An eighth grader.
Yes.
I have something just for your kid.
Okay, good. I'm listening.
Basic training is it's kind of a rite of passage that we offer for our eighth grade students. We will kind of take a couple weeks just with them during the third hour service, and we will ask really big questions about our faith. Why should we believe the Bible? Why is Jesus that important? What is the deal with church? All these kinds of really big questions, and we will kind of together find answers for those. So it's kind of a rite of passage, really asking some really big questions of our faith. And so there is an application for that, though. So that is all available online at the website that's there in the bulletin. That starts next week, so the application deadline is actually today. It's not a long application. You just tell us that you're coming, and that starts next week, and I'm really excited for that.
Also on the bulletin was an announcement here for Discover Riverwood. If you are newer to our church, we would love to spend some time telling you about all of the inner workings of our finance board and our elders and our structure and what we believe and all of that. And so Discover Riverwood is a chance to do that all in one time from 8:30 to 12 on February 11th on a Saturday morning. And the great thing about that is it's also a prerequisite to become a member of our church. So if you go through that, you can then go through membership. So I just want to make you aware that that time is coming on February 11th. Our next announcement is one that is with great joy we are announcing that we are adding another pastor to our team here at Riverwood. His name is Jeff Haynes, and Jeff is going to be a pastor of adult discipleship here at Riverwood. And we spent a lot of time, a long journey, looking at resumes and interviewing and all of that. And we have landed, and God has really pointed us in the direction, and for Jeff as well. He feels a great connection here at Riverwood. Jeff and his wife, Allison, have three kids. He has, as you can tell by the picture, he has a girl who is going to be graduating high school, one who's going to be going into high school, and he has a four-year-old. And so he has a wide variety of ages there. But Jeff also, he's a church planter by nature. He was a youth pastor for a number of years, but his passion is discipleship, and he knows that's where God is calling him to spend some significant years of his life to doing exactly that. And so he's excited to join us. He was born in Indiana. He currently lives in North Carolina, and so he's going to be moving to the great state of Ohio. Right? All right. But February 19th, he will be here with his family and beginning that journey with us. And so we're excited to add Jeff to our church family here. All right, I think that's all of our announcements as we continue in our worship.
Well, it's great to be with you all today. Today is a special time. This morning is a special time. You may worship God throughout the week, but this is even different than that. It's when we all come together as the church to do this together. And that's the purpose of this time. So we will sing songs together this morning about Christ and who he is and what he's done for us. We will hear from the scriptures revealing what Christ has done for us. And so, church, as we stand, let me pray for us as we begin our morning looking to the Lord. You can stand. God, we thank you so much for the chance you have given us, your people, to come together to look to you, to declare our need for you, to worship you, to lift you up, to be reminded again of what you have done for us through Christ and going to the cross on our behalf. So God, as we spend time looking to you today, would you please teach us? Would your Holy Spirit please teach us? Would you please convict us of our sin and help us to repent to you of those things that are dishonoring to you, that aren't pleasing to you, that go against the ways that you would have us live. Lord, I pray that you would bless our time this morning, that you would lead us in it. We love you and we give you this time now. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Become his righteousness. He humbled
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my soul shall ever be.
Marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior.
Still, I fall in all my prayers.
come to you this morning to hear from your word. Holy Spirit, would you please teach us now as Cole shares what you have put on his heart to share with us. We love you. We desire to honor you this morning. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. In case you weren't here last week, you just saw what we talked about. What a beautiful song and words that tells the story of the younger son. Well, as you know, we have kids amongst us, and we are so glad you are here. About four or five times a year, we have kids join us in this room by design so that they understand and see what adults do in this room as they sing songs, as we talk about the scriptures, as we hear the scriptures read. And it's great to have kids amongst us. This is the body of Christ in all of its diversity and of age together. So it's a beautiful thing. So thanks for being here, kids. And so this morning, we start with this introduction. There was a man who had two sons. And immediately, our brains go to, what were those sons like? What were their personalities like? You know, you have these older sons, and then you have a younger son, and all of the personality traits that make you, you. Now, books have been written predicting people's personality based on their birth order. I don't know if you've ever done any reading on that. But anyway, what we're going to do in the next couple of minutes here, we're going to perform our own predictor of birth order. So hopefully, kids, you have one of those little bulletins with the quiz and there's questions. If not, we're going to show the questions on the screen here one at a time. Parents, you can kind of play along too. All right, so there's five questions. First question is this, A, B, or C. When I have homework, I like to get it done and mark it off my list, A. B, find someone to do my homework with. Or C, what homework? I have plenty of time to do it later. Which one is you? All right, next question, question two. When mom looks at my room, she says, could you help your brother organize his room? Which shelf is yours? Or can you clear a path through the stuff on the floor from the door to your bed? Which one is yours? All right, question three. When I'm bored, I like to A, find mom to ask what we're doing today. B, find my sister or brother to play. Or C, put on a show for my family. Question four. When I get ready for school, I get out my clothes the night before. I see what my best friend is wearing to school. Or C, I find my favorite outfit and wear it to bed so I don't have to change in the morning. And then finally, when hanging out with my friends, I, A, decide what we are going to play and what the rules are. B, what my friends want to do so I can figure out something everyone wants to play. Or C, make up a game we can play. A, B, C. All right, so our generic predictor of birth order goes something like this. If you answered mostly A's, you are most likely the eldest or an only child. If you answered B mostly, you're most likely stuck in the middle somewhere in your family, or C, you are the youngest. So how many did we predict correct? Let's show of hands. How many were incorrect? You're somebody else. All right, well, it is a predictor, so anyway. But there is something that as you look at the way God made you, you in your personality is one thing, but God cares about something else that's going on in your life that is so much more important. Your personality is one thing, but the thing he really cares about is your heart. And when I'm talking about your heart, I'm not talking about this organ that's just pumping blood in your body. I'm talking about something that is much deeper, your passions, your thoughts, your attitudes, deep inside. God cares about your heart and the condition of your heart. And you're thinking, well, what is the condition of my heart? Well, great indicators of the condition of your heart are these kinds of things. The ways you act and the ways you treat others. The ways you respond to your parents when they ask you to do things. And even the words that come out of your mouth are great indicators of the health of your heart. See, that's what God cares about, your heart. And as we look at a story this morning in Luke chapter 15, we're going to look at a story about the heart, because God cares deeply about what's going on inside of you. And so as a church, we've been praying this prayer, dear God, break my heart for what breaks yours, because we want our heart eventually to look exactly like his. We have a lot of work to be done in that area of what our heart should look like, but we want something that looks and beats for the things that God has passions for. And so this morning we're going to look at a story where this is going to be the major point, and we're going to look at a story in the New Testament, in the book of Luke chapter 15. You can turn your Bibles there. We're going to be there. We're going to look at it together. But it's a parable. It's a story. And parables are short stories that have one major point that the author and the storyteller is trying to tell. And in Luke chapter 15, the story is being told by Jesus. But those who are listening on the outside, there's two groups of people. There are, as the word says, there's sinners and tax collectors who are listening. But there's also these people called Pharisees and scribes, the ones who had a problem with their heart. And we're going to look at that in a little bit. So the book of Luke chapter 15, the story starts off. Last week we talked about there's two sons. The one son is the younger son who goes, he takes his father's inheritance, and he spends it all. And then he eventually hits rock bottom. He then comes home thinking, oh, there's no way my father will even accept me. And to his surprise, his father runs out, embraces him, hugs him, and welcomes him home and says, hey, there's going to be a celebration, a feast, for my son who was dead is now alive. The son who was lost is now found. And last week we looked at this painting. I don't know if you've ever seen this painting, but this is the painting of Rembrandt. It's a very dark painting. Can we show the painting? All right, it's a painting where you would see a father embracing his son. And off to the, oh, there it is. You see the father embracing his son, the young son, and his son who is missing a shoe, and he's just weathered and worn out. That's the young son. And then off to the side, you have the elder son, the older son. And he's there kind of glaring and looking at this whole thing taking place. That's who we're going to look at this morning. And in this painting and in this parable, our Heavenly Father God is the Father. And he welcomes those who are lost. And there's actually two lost sons in this picture. One who is kneeling and one who is now looking at the other two, the older son. All right, so let's get into the story, this parable. Chapter 15, verse 25. In your Bible, you can follow along, or if not, you can follow along on the screens. It says this, now his older son was in the field, and as he came, he drew near to the house. He heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants, and he asked what these things meant. And he, the servant, he said to him, your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound. An interesting detail as we begin this story, that the older son is now on his own journey going back home. Not as long as the younger son who was in a faraway country, but the older son who was just out in the fields for the day is now coming back to the homestead. A long day of working. And the thing that catches his attention is this thing of music and dancing. I don't know about you, when I hear music and dancing, you know what I think of? A wedding. And you should see me on the dance floor at a wedding. Actually, you wouldn't want to see me on the dance floor at a wedding. But that's what I think about, the celebration of a wedding. There's music and there's dancing and there's a great time to be had. That's what's going on here in the story. But what is the most shocking to the oldest son is that the celebration is taking place for who? His brother is home? He's inside? He's the reason why this party is taking place. And they're having a fattened calf moment. The fattened calf meant that they were having the best food. Now, kids, let me ask you this question. On the count of three, if you're having a major celebration in your family, where are you going to go out to eat? On the count of three, you're going to say where that place is, okay? One, two, three. Okay, I did hear it. McDonald's. That's right. And all those other fast food places where you celebrate big moments. That's what's going on here. There's a celebration of epic proportions. Now, the question is this going to be good news for the older brother? Is he like so happy his brother is back? Is that what's going to happen here? Let's find out. Verse 28, it says this, but he, this is the older son now, he was angry and he refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. All right, so the son hears the celebration, he sees the reason for it, and he is not happy. The text, it says it right there, he is angry, angry. So there he is on the porch, seething with anger. How can this take place? Why is this happening? And notice the father, he's now coming out from the celebration. It's very specific. He's coming towards him, much like he came out for the younger son. Remember, the younger son was coming up the driveway and he runs out to him. Same thing. The father comes out onto the porch where the older son is. And he starts to, it says, he's entreating him. Entreating means he's inviting him. It's a kind word. He's having compassion. There's an invitation. Come, we're having a party inside. We're missing you. Come on in. See, he's not the father who's coming out to say, put on your happy face and get inside. No, he's not threatening them. The parents never threaten kids like that. I know they don't. He's inviting them. Come inside. There's a party. We don't want you to miss it. And so far, we have gotten a glimpse of the heart of the father and the heart of the older son. There's anger rolling around inside. There's going to be some more things we're going to learn about his heart as well as we hear him speak. And so in verse 29, the younger son, now having this invitation, he now says this. But he answered his father, look, these many years I have served you. I have never disobeyed your commands, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with women, you killed the fattened calf for him. Again, more interesting words that reveal at a deeper level what is going on inside of the lost son. And the son's words can really be divided into three categories. He has his I statements, he has his he statements, and he has his you statements. And he starts off saying, let's just check my record here. I have done everything I can do. I have served you. I have gone out of my way. I've never disobeyed any of your commands. I have done wonderful things. And he's listing out his resume of all of the great things he has done. And then he contrasts that with the he statements. Let me tell you about that son of yours. He's wasted everything. He devoured your property. He spent all of it. Which is kind of interesting because as the elder son came to the house, he didn't even know the younger son was even there. But he's got a long list of complaints against him. But the most accusing words are really the you statements. I've done this, he's done that, but you! You're someone who is a hard slave driver. That's what those words mean, where I served you. It's actually slavery. I have slaved for you. You're such a harsh man. And you have all of these commands. And these rules that you have in your house make no sense because now you're having a celebration for him. And this is the words the son has about his own family. And as he was describing that, I was kind of thinking through my own family this past week and thinking about my own father. We see we always resonate to the fathers we grew up with. And I grew up in a home where my father loved me and cared for me. We spent a lot of great moments together. He is the one who showed me how to play golf. He's the one that we just spent a lot of time with me, showing me how life is. And I am grateful. And as I was thinking about my own relationship with my father, the last words I would come to think about him would be these words of slavery and disobedient commandments. And those are words you use when you don't have that kind of close relationship. And that's what's evolving here in the story. And there's really one word it kind of centers around for me as I think about this older son. It really comes down to this thing. And anyone know what this is? Scorecard. Yeah. Speaking of golf, this is a scorecard. And for when I look at the older son, I think of scorecards. Because a scorecard is very exact. I scored this, 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 and this. Look at how well I did. And that's what the older son is saying. He said, look at my score. And oh, by the way, look at your other son's score. Not very good scores. And so for him, he's comparing it to scorecards and rules. It was all about rules. And the most frustrating thing for the elder son is also the father who's not playing by the scorecard. Your older son is doing this. Your younger son is doing this. Hence, why are you having a celebration for him? It makes no sense. And it was all about rules and rules and rules. And the truth is, if it is all about rules, then notice what this statement says here. If we have a heart that is all about, and the next blank there is rules. If we have a heart that is all about rules, that is a heart that is filled with, here's another R word, resentment towards others who are lost. And that's exactly what's happening to the older son. His heart is filled with rules. And then when he starts looking around, he has bitterness, and there's jealousy, and there's feelings of injustice and blame, and this doesn't make sense. And at the end of the day, that is his heart. Well, let's see how the father reacts to all of this, to the heart of his older son. Verse 31, this is what he says. And he said to him, this is the father speaking, son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. And what we see at the heart of the father is his reaction is very tender and kind, and quite opposite to the reaction of the son, whose reaction was very harsh. And at the very beginning, he uses a word that's very tender, and he says, son, listen to me, son. Now, culturally, in our own culture, we probably don't use it that way to speak in a tender way to our own kids. We might use their name as opposed to, son, listen to me. But this is a very tender moment. And in a very endearing way, he's saying, let's talk. And he says, all I have is yours. I'm with you the whole time. You haven't seen it. I've been there, walking with you, relating to you. That's what's going on. The son is just in anger over the whole thing, but he doesn't realize what the father is doing. And he communicates to the older son that he has a special place in his heart. And he says, everything that I have is yours, even those, I know you have this thing against this fattened calf, but guess what? That fattened calf was for you too. Not just for him, it's for my sons. And what the father is communicating is what is really in his heart. And it's not a heart that's rule-based with scorecards and keeping track and comparisons and this and that. It's none of that. But in the heart of the Father, it is about a different word that starts with R, and that is relationship. Relationship. You are my son. And, oh, by the way, notice what he says, that other you say that's my son inside celebrating, but guess what? He's your brother. Relationship. My son. My son, your brother, family, relationship. And so we go to the next slide as we talk about a heart that's all about rules and heads you down the roads of resentment. But that doesn't have to be true. Please hear the truth this morning. That a heart that is all about relationship is one that then can get you to a point of not of resentment, but a heart that rejoices when people who are lost come back again. And that is the heart of our Heavenly Father. It's about relationship. And one that he rejoices in those who've been away for a while or those who might have been out in the fields working. He rejoices when those who come back to him. Well, here in verse 32 is the end of the parable. And a lot of people are wondering, well, what would verse 33 be like? There's not one, but if there was verse 33, what's really the continuing story? How did it end? And in our minds, we think, the elder son, he then got onto the porch, he opened that door, and he ran inside, and he found his brother, and he hugged him, and he welcomed him back home again. Or the other ending is he stands there on the porch, continuing to be angry and resentful. And he never opens that door. Because there's way too much going on in his heart where he's trying to figure out all the rules and all the injustice, and he never goes in. See, Jesus tells this story with an incomplete ending for those who are listening in the first century, who are right there, those Pharisees and scribes. This story was for them. Choose your ending. What's going to happen? Where are you going to end up? And 2,000 years later, this story still has no ending for our benefit as well. For us to ask the harder questions about, in this parable, where do we see ourselves and how are we living our lives and how are we going to finish? And it really points us to a deeper conversation about the heart, your heart, my heart, what's going on inside, and whether you're 16 or whether you're 76, it's a conversation about what's going on inside. You see, on the one hand, we can live lives with resentful, rules-based hearts. And if this is what defines our heart, then there are huge implications for this. Please hear me. Because there are huge implications of what this really means in bad ways. There's bad news if this is what defines us. And the biggest is that this heart, if it's all about rules and comparing ourselves to others and earning and being good enough, and if that's all that is in our heart, then we will forever be separated from our Heavenly Father. We'll always be on the porch looking in at the feast with high degrees of resentment. And if that is what our heart is about, measuring up and comparing ourselves, and I'm better than that person, and I've done enough good, and we have missed the heart of the gospel, the good news. And the bad news continues that if we have that kind of heart, then we will never have a heart like our Heavenly Father's for those who are lost, for those who are the younger brothers that God puts in our lives. Because we'll always have our scorecard out thinking, well, that person really shouldn't because they act like that, or that person says this, or that person does that, and we have it all figured out on our scorecards. And I'm better than that person, and that person's worse than me, and so they're not good enough, and we have it all figured out based on rules. And God says, no, that's not my heart. That's not what it's about. It's not about keeping track of being good enough. It's about a relationship. Do you know who I am? I'm the God who loves you. Put the scorecard away. You can never do enough good things. Come to me, because I have given you a gift through a relationship through my Son, Jesus Christ. It's about what He has done, not about you. And whether, again, you're 16 or 76, it's about having a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so, kids, please hear that truth this morning as well. And maybe even before you go to bed tonight, having a conversation with your parents about a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's vitally important. And then on top of that, the next conversation then goes into this conversation about when He then comes into our life and He gives us a new heart, we now have a heart that looks like His, that is open to rejoicing when the lost are then found. And see, we get rid of our scorecards and we start loving people and desiring them to come to know our Heavenly Father like we have. And it's not this thing about comparisons and you missed this and that. No, it's about praying deep and praying hard for lost people in our lives, praying hard for those who don't understand. And that might be our own kids. That might be the people who live next door to us. That might be the person who you sit next to at lunch. Praying hard that God would use you and tap that person on the shoulder to come up the driveway so that their Heavenly Father can welcome them into the feast, into the celebration. And then, and when those moments happen, it's not like we're sitting there thinking, oh, can't believe that person is in. No. But our heart is rejoicing and glad for what was once lost is now found. Let me pray for us. Dear Lord, we thank You for Your word that challenges us to live life differently. I pray for all of the kids who are here this morning. I pray that they have heard Your truth and Your gospel, that You want to have a relationship with them, inviting them into a celebratory feast, to live life walking with their Heavenly Father. You are good and caring, entreating us to walk with You and have a relationship with You. I pray for everybody here who's been trying to do it on rules and scorecards. I pray, Lord, that You would allow them to have a moment where they're just ripping that up, seeing it as something that's faulty kind of understanding. The Heavenly Father has a different way, and it's through relationship. And may we hear that fresh. May we hear that for ourselves this morning. And may you turn this church upside down to be a place that rejoices for those who come. Those who come who don't look like us, those who come who don't actually fit the kind of paradigm that we think should be in church, those who come, may we welcome them in and rejoice when the lost are found. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
Hear the word of the Lord from Ephesians 2. And you were dead in the trespasses and sin, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast.
Isaiah 64, 6 talks about these things that we do to try to please God without our hearts being changed. It says it like this, that all our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment or like filthy rags in need of washing, in need of being tossed out. It says the offering baskets will be passed around, and as this is happening, the song is playing, be asking God to change your heart, to remind you of what it looks like to have the relationship with him that he desires and not just be doing the things that he wants. So ushers, would you please serve us now?
Have done can save my guilty soul. Not what my toiling flesh has borne can make my spirit whole. Not what I feel or do can give me peace with God. Not all my prayers and sighs and tears can bear my awful load. These guilty hands are raised, filthy rags are all I bring, and I have come to hide beneath your wing. These holy hands are raised, washed in the fountain of your grace, and now I'm where your righteousness. Thy work alone, O Christ, can ease this weight of sin. Thy blood alone, O Lamb of God, can give me peace within. Thy love to me, O God, now mine, O Lord, to Thee. Rid me of this dark unrest and set my spirit free. These guilty hands are raised, filthy rags are all I bring, and I have come to hide. our bondage break. No other work save thine, no other blood will do. Our strength with that which is divine can bear me safely through. He's guilty and sorry. My joy, my light. My Lord has saved my life and freely pardoned gifts. I love because He first loved me. I live because He lived.
Let's pray. Father, we thank You for this time here this morning. We've sung praises. We've heard Your word. We've enjoyed time with our families this morning and the blessing of those relationships. And God, we pray that as a church, You'll direct our steps as we minister to our families. Convict and empower us to disciple our children, Lord. And we pray that Riverwood will be a community that surrounds and celebrates its young people as they take steps along their journey of faith. Lord, we pray also that You'll strengthen our marriages and heal those that are hurting. Your church is who we are, Lord, and we thank You for bringing us together as the body of Christ. We thank You for Christ and for His sacrifice. Lord, we're not worthy of this pardon that You granted us. You've saved us despite our mistakes, despite the things that we do wrong and the ways that we wander. We are all lost. But we've all been found in Christ. Thank You for welcoming us and accepting us despite all this. Lord, help us to show grace and mercy to others in the way that You've shown it to us. Help us to follow Your example in all we do in our work and in our families, in our community, in all of our relationships. And as we leave here this morning, may we reflect on the life that You've given us. And the grace that has saved us, may it be visible to others in a way that brings honor and glory to You and only to You. Father, we pray for the missionaries we support who do this far from home. This morning we pray for Jim and Marion Moore with Wycliffe Bible Translators. Pray that You'll continue to provide for their needs, especially a home this year as they seek that. We pray for the work that Jim's doing to help Wycliffe prepare to respond to crisis situations where their workers are throughout the world. We pray for the translation teams that You'll protect them and that they'll be able to do their work despite social and political challenges throughout the world where they work. Lord, as we leave here now, and go into a new week, we pray that we will honor you and do what is required of us, to do what is right, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, our God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, church, can we stand one more time together?
Hallelujah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus is my
Just for a couple more minutes, and a couple times a year, we have an update of where we are financially, and I just wanted to introduce you Brent Sharp. He's the chairman of our finance, our fiduciary board here at Riverwood, and so he's going to give us kind of a lowdown on 2016, and I see a slide with lots of numbers on there, Brent, so kind of explain some of those to us.
I will try. There we go. Yeah. I'll try. Now, first and foremost, it's been this year of standing up here and being able to give you an update. It's been wonderful. Your blessing to the church, God's blessings to you, have made this very easy and actually kind of fun. So there's more good news today. On the slide behind me, you'll see there's a top half and a bottom half. And on the top half, it kind of breaks down the donations that we've had in 2016 over 2015. You can see our offerings in the top line general are a little bit up, a little bit higher. Outreach is definitely higher, and that's enabled us to do some really neat things. The debt and building line you can see is a little bit lower, but that's because in 2015, we actually had the emphasis to pay down the debt. And so that's why it's a little higher. We'll get to that in a minute. You can see overall the total donations are pretty even, just slightly higher this year. Now to the really fun stuff, the finances on the bottom. As you can see, our offering 2016 through 2015 is definitely higher, and that speaks to your blessings as God has blessed you and how you've been faithful to the church. And the expenses you can see are lower. We set the budget lower thanks to my predecessor, Greg, who I see sitting right there. Made sure and set the budget lower in 2016. We worked at that to be good stewards, and it's paid off. You can see our surplus there is a lot higher this year, and that's mainly the biggest reason that is due to our debt payoff that we paid off last year, so now we've had a lot of savings. One thing I can tell you for sure that has been an emphasis of the fiduciary committee is to make sure and funnel those monies back into things like missions, and we've increased our missions this year and kind of hit a personal goal that we had at 10% of giving back to our own missionaries and those kinds of things. So it's very, very thankful to you guys as a congregation for how your good stewardship and how you've blessed the church. Thank you.
It's a great story. Thank you for your generosity. And I know people have also been asking, and we've been talking about building, where are we at with that? And all that to say, behind the scenes, there have been a lot of meetings happening, and we've been meeting with our builder, and there's a great story. We're going to share more of those details next week, but we're excited to see where God is leading us in kind of that next chapter of where he's leading. And we've been doing a lot of things with hiring staff, and it's been a busy kind of last month, but we're excited to kind of share the vision of where we are headed with you in that as well. So as we go, why don't we stand and say our benediction together? And kids, we say these words every week as kind of a closing to the service, and so you can say them along with us. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in his grace today.